Chris Johnston joining us to talk about this topic, which there's so many different ways to go. Let's start with Matt Duchene. Everyone is talking about him. What are you hearing about Matt Duchene and the Sens?
Well, I'd say at this point, among the big players that are out there on the market, Matt Duchene is the most likely and perhaps the first one we're going to see move. In fact, the Ottawa Senators have got to the point where they don't plan to dress him for their next game on Thursday night, just to protect the asset, just because it's hockey. Things can happen. I don't think that that is because a trade is pending any moment now, but they recognize that this is a player they're not going to be able to reach a contract extension with. It's sort of been trending in that direction for some time now, and so Matt Duchene essentially has to wait. It might even carry into the weekend. The Senators also play on Friday night, so he might sit a couple games before he finds out his fate. But at this point, I'd say it's likely Matt Duchene has played his last game in Ottawa.
Keeping the focus on the Sens, Mark Stone, what are you hearing centering on him?
Well, the situation with Stone is a little bit different because the Senators haven't ruled out the possibility of extending him at this point. But at the same time, they're also having talks with other teams about potentially moving Mark Stone. And from what I'm hearing, the price is very large. One team that phoned yesterday to Pierre Dorion was told two first-rounders and two grade-A prospects. I mean, essentially the kind of haul we never see anyone get at the trade deadline. You know, there's still some bit of a dance to be had here, obviously not wanting to give him away for nothing. There's a negotiation going on. But, you know, right now he's kind of could go both ways. And if Mark Stone does get traded, I would expect he'll get a huge haul back for the Senators.
Our resident GM, Brian Lawton, aghast when you shared that fact. On to the Wayne train. Wayne Simmonds, the Flyers surging, 12-1-1 in their last 14. What happens with Wayne Simmonds?
Well, you got, if you're Chuck Fletcher, the new GM of the Flyers, you got two things going on. Your team today, but also the long term of the organization. And I think, you know, with Wayne Simmonds, it's about asset management in the big picture, and it just doesn't seem as though there's been much happening on the contract side for him. So I would expect this is a guy we'll be talking about by next Monday's deadline at 3 p.m. Eastern, has been moved on. You know, at this point, though, with these other forwards kind of dominating discussion, it might take some time before the traction really picks up on trade talks. But, you know, Wayne Simmonds, I believe, is down to his last days as a Flyer.
There is so much discussion about the Columbus Blue Jackets, and there has been for months and months. Panarin, Bobrovsky, as we get closer and closer to the deadline, the urgency picks up. What's the latest?
Well, the guy that really interests me is Panarin. You know, but Sergei Bobrovsky has a no-move clause in his contract. He's a goaltender. There's some complicating factors to a deal involving him. Whereas Artemi Panarin is a top scorer in this league and a player with no trade restrictions. And obviously, there's a lot of interest in him. He's not playing the game in Montreal this evening. And, you know, one thing the Blue Jackets were quick to dispel, this is not asset management. This is not protecting him. He's just ill. And, you know, I think what's interesting in his case is that the Blue Jackets have been so secretive about what's going on. They've really kept their cards close to the vest, both when teams call and not naming what sort of price it would take, and secondly, not releasing much info. So, you know, I do think it's very likely he's moved, but there's a little bit more secrecy here, and you know, obviously he's a player. If Columbus doesn't move him, will still help their push towards the playoffs.
How about Derek Brassard? I read an article where he talked about how challenging it was, how frustrating it was, and how relieved he's been since he's been in Sunrise. Where does he go at or before the trade deadline?
Well, unfortunately, I don't think Derek should unpack at this point because, you know, the Florida Panthers, they had a huge mountain to climb when that trade was made with the Pittsburgh Penguins. But, you know, Dale Tallon at that point in time wanted to see how his team would respond with both Riley Shan and Derek Brassard. You know, they've been around 500 since that point. And I would expect by Monday now he'll be on the market. There's certainly already interest out there in him. A player who can play both center and the wing. And, you know, he's been well-traveled the last few years between Ottawa, Pittsburgh, and now Florida. And I think he's got another destination coming in the next few days.
And we remember him as Big Game Brass, producing for the Rangers deep into a playoff run. Chris Johnston, great intel as always. Thanks so much.
They were playing well against the best team in hockey, the Tampa Bay Lightning, but then a couple of mistakes just compounded. What did you see there from the Blue Jackets?
Well, the first 12 minutes, I thought they were the better team. They were a better team for most of this, but if you just watch, then they didn't manage the puck. Right here, if you watch, Pierre-Luc Dubois. First, Seth Jones is joining the play. You want your D to join the play, but you're playing against the best line in hockey, Kucherov, the best player. I'd like to see the puck get kicked back out to Panarin there, but he holds the puck. Nice play by McDonough. Now here's the indirect Seth Jones trap. Now watch Werenski. Werenski, it's a two-on-one. Seth Jones was trapped because of the turnover. You got to protect and keep backing up. Let Korpisalo have Gord. That's your guy, Kucherov. Buy some time. Let Gord have the shot, if anything, but you leave the most dangerous guy. But it all starts right here. Pierre-Luc Dubois should have kicked it back to Panarin. Now you got four guys trapped. Now, like I said, Werenski, you're leaving good ice for bad ice. You leave Kucherov wide open, and what does he do? He makes you pay. This is what this guy can do. Here's the second play. Nice long stretch pass. Seth Jones, you're out there against the best line again. But here's Foligno. There's Seth Jones. Now guess what happens? Foligno gets a little fancy, a little cute. This is what this team will do. They'll make you pay. He doesn't get it deep. Now Seth Jones trapped once again. You got four Blue Jackets caught. Werenski gets caught flat-footed. And who's it? Once again, there's Kucherov, the best scorer in the National Hockey League. This can't happen. You're a young team. You're playing the best team. Werenski, twice you get beat here, and Seth Jones gets trapped twice. Yes, you want your D to join the play, but for me, Werenski and Seth Jones, you're out there to protect against Kucherov. This guy's been on fire. Best player in hockey right now. Best team in hockey. You want to see how you measure up. You got to play the right way. You got to defend. You got to play. Just don't give those guys anything. Yes, it's nice to score, but you got to stay back a bit and be a little more patient. The game was going beautiful for John Tortorella and the Blue Jackets until this point here. Then they got in penalty trouble, and it's 3-0, and that's what this team can do. Yeah. If you don't play the game the right way, manage the puck for 60 minutes, you're not going to beat this team. And I think this was a good lesson for the young Columbus Blue Jacket team because they still are young. They have a lot of bright future ahead of them, but they just got schooled by a very good hockey club.
Yeah, and Tangs, when you watch that from the Tampa Bay Lightning side, you say, of course, they're going to jump right on that.
We talked about it earlier in the show. It's about closing gaps. McDonough, great gap at the blue line. Yes. Did not allow Pierre-Luc Dubois, who had the puck in the middle, to get that blue line and then makes the play. Quick transition. You transition to speed. You give time and space to good players like Nikita Kucherov, like Yanni Gord, like Steven Stamkos, like Brayden Point. That list can go on and on in Tampa. So if you're going to do those mistakes against a team like that, you know, the way to beat the Tampa Bay Lightning is to make them earn everything, because the longer that they go without scoring, the more that you feel you're in the game, the more that they start doubting themselves. Sometimes the team that's been playing great, the frustration creeps in, and then they may make that mistake of not chipping the puck in deep or making that mistake of creating that turnover. And when you do that against good teams like that, you're going to give yourselves a chance at winning the game.
And that will do it. The Florida Panthers come away with a comeback win. How about the Buffalo Sabres? This was a team a lot of Buffalo fans had hoped would finally make it back to the playoffs this year, but things are starting to look like they might be running out of gas. They've actually been outscored 9-1 in the third period over their last three games, and that includes this one. Of course, they had that 1-0 lead, but it's slipping away, and it might be too little too late for the Buffalo Sabres. What do you think?
Yeah, a little fool's gold with that start. I mean, they had a great start, but I still think they're a few pieces away. I mean, they're a young team. They need some more pieces to help Eichel. We'll see what happens with Skinner. He's been nice scoring goals. Reinhardt's had a great year. They have the young Dahlin, who's still learning his position. He's going to get better, bigger, and stronger. So I think the future's good for the Buffalo Sabres, but I still think they have a little ways to go. They need a few more pieces, like I said. But Dahlin's going to be a good player, but he just has to get some strength. And he's not used to this type of schedule, this long a schedule. He's used to a shorter schedule, so it's going to take some time for him to develop and become a good, solid, dominant defenseman in this league.
And another team that had to come from behind is the Florida Panthers. But they did just that thanks to Jonathan Huberdeau's 1 and then 2 goals on the night. He recorded 3 points in the third period alone against the Buffalo Sabres, and that was the difference.
That was the difference. I mean, Jonathan Huberdeau, Alexander Barkov, they've been playing outstanding the last couple games. Barkov had the hat trick. Last game, Huberdeau, 2 goals and 1 assist tonight. And I like the play. The little play that they made on the last goal there. Those two have been playing a little bit like the Sedin down deep in the corners. And what I mean by that is they go at each other. Sometimes, you know, skill guys, they like to spread things out. But as Scott could tell you, and you can ask him anytime, if you get two guys going at each other and skating together, all of a sudden they can do a little pick for each other. And that's exactly what happened. Huberdeau skated toward Barkov, passed the puck. Barkov just laid the puck back. Pick Huberdeau's guys, and then all of a sudden Skinner that was behind could not quite react to it, so that allowed Huberdeau time and space. And with skills, if you give them time and space, they're going to make you pay for it, and that's exactly what they did.
Yeah, they got nice chemistry going there, and Skinner loses his guy. Rasmus Ristolainen takes his guy. Skinner gets caught a little flat-footed, and he's a great skater, but just a great little interchange, little confusion to the defenders, and Huberdeau makes him pay.
And so the Florida Panthers come away with the 2 points at home against the Buffalo Sabres. Yes, it is an overtime game winner presented by EA Sports NHL 19. Ryan O'Reilly playing the hero. It's his 9th career overtime goal. And like you said, Scotty, taking it from end to end, doing it with skill.
Absolutely. He's a great defensive centerman. He plays a 200-foot game, highly intelligent, incredible IQ, like Tang said. And I like just how he disguises his shot. And you see Anderson has no idea it's passed him before he realizes it's off his stick. This is hard to do, but like you say, he practices this play. And just incredible. Very hard to do, but great job disguising the shot, going top shelf on Freddie Anderson.
The Blues, are they going to just, when are they going to have this winning streak end, Tangs?
They believe now, and that's, you know, so oftentimes the most important thing. As Ryan O'Reilly said in the interview, they were trailing, or not trailing, but they gave up a 2-goal lead in the third period. And sometimes, you know, a team that's fragile, a team that's got, you know, some not sure about how to play their system or not sure they have the belief in themselves, they'll crack down. They'll give up that extra goals, but did not panic on the bench. They focused, they rallied, they believed that they were going to be able to find a way to get it done, and they capitalized based on the fact that they have that belief now. So when is it going to end? I don't know. But
It's a phenomenal feeling in Tangs. I'm sure you've been there. When this happens, you get a roll like this, you just feel every night you're going to win. And you're not cocky, you're not arrogant. It just, you have the feeling in your room, and you look at everyone in the eye, and you know you're going to win that game. And that's what the Blues have right now. They know they're going to win every game or have a chance. And right now, 11 games, that's phenomenal. They got to be feeling very good about themselves.
Yeah, the Blues missed the playoffs by just 1 point last year, and they will try to get back in it this year. Looking like they certainly can if they keep this up. Remember this guy? He drove 5 hours to see Connor McDavid play. Connor McDavid is out of the lineup, but stay tuned. We have a happy ending to this story. Time for the clutch performance of the night presented by Bridgestone, and we go back to Carolina where the Hurricanes tried to solve Henrik Lundqvist all night, but no could do. They did get one goal against him, but Hank finished with 43 saves and got the win. And this is just continuing a pattern for him, guys. He's been great against the Canes throughout his career, as you see right here.
He's pretty limber the way he's moving. He's getting older, but he's getting better. Much like fine wine, we've talked about that before, but he's playing good. You can see some of those big saves he made for the young Ranger team, and that's what they need. They need Lundqvist to be good here for this young team going forward, and he was spectacular tonight.
And the way that he plays is very impressive to me because he plays deep in his net. And for a goalie, as you get older, you don't need to use your skating ability quite as much. He plays deep, he plays big, and, you know, you've played with Brodeur, I've played with Patrick Roy, and later in their career, I thought that they stayed back a little bit. They, depending on their positioning, their experience, their understanding of the game to get themselves better. And as Henrik Lundqvist has evolved throughout his career, I see him more and more. And we saw him in some of those highlights, deep in his net, big body, protecting as much net as possible and making sure that he's in the right position. When you do that, the puck's going to find a way to hit you.
Yeah, you might have a little more time to see it when you stay back a bit too, but you have to have quick reflexes, and he's showing that he has those.
He said that he wants to stay in New York for the remainder of his career, and that is music to Rangers fans' ears. He has been phenomenal once again for them this year. When we come back, speaking of great goaltending, how about Ryan Miller? He has had quite the night in Minnesota, so too has Scorey Perry, as you see here. We'll update you on that game next. They entered just 5 points behind Minnesota. Now they are 3 points back of a playoff spot. And it is thanks to a Pepsi Zero Sugar shutout by Ryan Miller. Guys, what'd you see out of him? 31 saves in this one.
Well, just go ahead, Tanks.
He's big, he's strong, and let's not forget the type of season that he had early in the season. He played great early in the year. He's big, he's transitioned, and he understands the role of backup. And I think that he's played, and you see the stats, he's had tremendous stats.
Yeah.
He's been a very good goalie. I mean, look at the numbers. I mean, he's proven, he's a veteran, he knows how to win hockey games.
Certainly does. Ryan Miller with yet another Pepsi Zero Sugar shutout.
Time now for your three stars of the night. Third star goes to Jonathan Huberdeau with two goals and a helper, all in the third period. Florida's 4-2 comeback victory over Buffalo. Second star goes to Ryan Miller, 31 save shutout, his first of the season and 44th of his career in the Ducks' 4-0 win over the Wild. And your first star goes to the St. Louis Blues, who extended their winning streak to a franchise record 11 straight, courtesy of Ryan O'Reilly's overtime game-winning goal. It's the longest streak in the NHL this season.
There's a slew of games tonight, lots of compelling stories.
It's 90s night, and Patrick Warburg is in the house.
He's just supporting the team, as he said back in the 90s.
They're not a bunch of jerks. They're just having good old-fashioned fun.
Sit back and enjoy this one off the faceoff.
It's Jacob Slavin coming underneath, saving a goal.
Lundqvist says no, they score!
And the jerks break the ice.
Take it away, Johansson, back in,
is a velvety touch.
Huberdeau is in! Huberdeau to the net! Hoobie dooby doo!
It's very much on here tonight.
Ryan O'Reilly scores! And it's a franchise record, 11th consecutive victory.
D'Angelo to the outside. He'll center one. It's loose to the crease, and the Canes keep it out.
He throws a puck at the net, and it nearly goes off of the stick of McElhinney into the net. It's Jacob Slavin coming underneath, saving a goal before Buchnevich can cash.
Wow. Sent ahead by Bratt, and the Devils chip it out of the zone. Mirko Mueller sends it the other way. Take it away, Johansson. Back in.
Oh,
score! Marcus Johansson, what a move!
This is just terrific from Marcus Johansson. The backhand upstairs in tight.
Huberdeau swings it back to the point. Held in there by Yandel. Yandel, Huberdeau. Got it in front. The shot right in. What a save by Ullmark. He speared that one with his catching glove and hangs on to it.
And that is a huge save right there.
Ellis, a nice backhand chip. Now sent ahead. Hartman to Grimaldi. Grimaldi's. He scores!
Watch this. He's going to get Hudobin to bite. He thinks he's going far side. Opens up that short side about a foot of net, and he just guides it right in.
Flyers penetrate here. Pass down to Lindblom. Looks cool mouth deflected off Domingue and cleared away by Coburn. The shot there. What a stop by Domingue there on Voracek. And a save. He gets a whistle.
The Flyers throwing pucks from angle. Just get it into the paint. Nobody can find the handle. That is terrific stuff there.
And it's a 2-on-1 the other way. O'Reilly and Tarasenko. Ryan O'Reilly scores!
He's coming in on 2-on-1. They're screaming at him. On man rush, on man rush. He just takes it, puts it up and over. Freddie Anderson uses the decoy of Tarasenko and puts it up and over. Bar down. And we have a winner. 11 straight for Ryan O'Reilly and the Blues.